From Atlanta, Georgia, it's the Atlanta Comedy Classic, serving up the hottest comedy in the South. Starring...
Hi, we're Pinsky and Gray.
You know, being a team can be a lot of fun, but there are drawbacks. You gotta split everything.
You want half the roll?
Yeah, I want half the roll. Give me half this.
No, I want the chicken.
Do you have to go to the restroom?
No. Do you?
Only if you do.
Okay, I gotta go.
I gotta go too,
though. Okay, let's go.
Okay, we'll have half.
You know, I like comedy for one thing and one thing only. The things that allows you to do with your spare time. For me, ham, honey. I bagged this baby at an A&P in Valdosta.
He killed my hog. He killed my hog.
So what kind of business was you in before you got in comedy?
I was in advertising. I spent 3 years in advertising. It's just so complicated. I mean, I just got out of the business. Like, first, like this thing here, this little display. I mean, a few years ago, there wasn't near that much detail. Take a look under here.
You're sick, man.
Take a look at this, Tim. Look under there.
I'm not going to look under there.
Hi, I'm Jeff Foxworthy. I left a job at IBM to be a comic because I wanted to be my own boss, set my own hours, control my own destiny.
Yeah, you do a good job. I'll tell the people you follow about you. They're mighty in. You missed a spot. I'm sorry.
Personally, I don't even know why I'm in this video with the rest of these degenerates. I'm only doing this comedy thing until my hockey knee gets back in shape. Then it's back to the Montreal Canadiens and on to the Stanley Cup.
That's what pisses me off. Right. That's not what I ordered. That's not animal cracker pudding.
It is?
No, see, ain't no elephants in there.
I be damned.
Ain't no animals at all. Ain't no rhinos, ain't no birds, ain't
no
giraffe.
Bunnies ain't a damn thing in there.
There's a duck. There's a duck in there.
Hi, I'm Lewis Nixon. I'm very excited about being in the show tonight. It's an honor to be in the show, and things are starting to take off for me now. These things take.
Thing this morning, you know. Jackie Onassis, the only woman alive, and pull out a half dollar, look at it, and think, yeah, I slept with her. Marilyn Monroe might, but she's gone too.
Oh, you're sick. You're sick.
And featuring.
Hi, Mark McCain.
And I'm Steve Mitchell.
From the 96 Rock Wake Up Crew.
Well, this is going to be neat. And you know what? The neat thing is, all these guys have appeared on our radio program one time or another.
And what's even more amazing than that, we still have our jobs after having them on our radio program. So what do you think about those apples?
Good catch.
Thank you. I think I broke a tooth on that one.
Thank you very much for coming tonight. We're going to have a wonderful time here at the 96 Rock Atlanta Comedy Classic.
Have we got some acts lined up for you or what? Some of the funniest people that have ever played Atlanta and gone on to bigger and better things. And they all got started right here on this
on
very
this stage.
Stage.
Yeah.
And not only that, we have had the opportunity through a very terrific relationship with the Punchline over the past year or so to have all of these people that you will see tonight on our morning show on 96 Rock. And boy, have they made us look good. Our ratings went woo, right
Absolutely.
Through the roof. They did.
Absolutely. So without further ado, let's get it rolling, shall we? We're going to turn it over to your emcee for the rest of the evening. This man.
This guy. We had him on, about a year ago?
Yeah.
And he bowled us over. He's from he's in Los Angeles now. He's from here, mm-hmm. Doing quite well out there. He just got a Ford commercial, Ford trucks.
That's
is that
right,
what he said?
Yeah. He's doing quite well. He was the winner of the Great Southeastern Laugh-Off here at the Punchline a few years back.
Voted
one of the 10 sexiest comedians in the country, according to Playgirl magazine.
Ladies.
Down.
And gentlemen, if you are ready, your emcee for the evening for the 96 Rock Atlanta Comedy Classic, Grant Turner.
Grant.
Hey. It is so good to be back in Atlanta, let me tell you. Moved to L.A. a year ago. 1 year ago, this month, I moved to L.A., my parents freaked out about that. If you're moved away from home and had your parents have to deal with that, my parents did not deal with that very well. I mean, it's like, I guess they think that Southern boys are somehow particularly vulnerable to that kind of environment out there. You know? My father kept going, all right, son, you move out there if you want to, but just remember what happened to Jim Neighbors. That's right, he said, you might find out the real reason he starts saying, golly. But that's the way he is, you know, he's one of those dads. And even in Little League, I mean, this guy wouldn't let me go anywhere without my athletic cup on. I mean, he had a pregame checklist. And he'd stop me, I'd be going out the door, he'd stop me and say, all right, son, Now, you got your hat, got your glove, you got your sliding pads. You got your cup on. All right, give it a thumper. Let me hear it. All right, good. You got in front this time. I like that. Had him back last game. You scared me and your mama. We thought you dropped a big one on the way to second. Tell everybody in the stands, stood up and said, don't slide, don't slide. Paranoid. He's also one of these people, probably like your parents, you know, at some point, you know, the people that are the product of the 40s and the 50s, they think bigger is better. You know, they see a big car and go, that must be a great car. It's like huge. I guess that's when he bought me the Boog Powell model of cup, you know. 8 years old, I'd walk on the field like some genetic mutant. The upper body of O.P. Taylor and the lower half of Tom Jones. Get up in the batter's box and get walked everywhere. Oh. Of course, my dad took advantage of that. He's up in the stands the whole time going, yeah, that's my boy out there. Built just like his daddy, look at it. Yeah, I don't see your boy casting a shadow with a pitcher's mound like that. It's like a dang sundial out there, look at it. Turn this way, son, I'm setting my watch. Boy, keeps good time with that thing. Yeah, we're probably all dazzled by this background here, aren't you? Isn't that, this has been a very effective advertising tool for the people at the Punchline, because a lot of people come in here, a lot of these guys that talk like this, hey, good to see you, how you doing? They wear these yellow ties, they sit back at the tables and go, yeah, it's my office right there. Go down there, look at that. Look at my office. Well, we got a great show for you. We really do. I mean, this is sort of a, you know, it's kind of a strange gathering here, but it is really, it's sort of a celebration of sickness. And it's a lot of sick minds. A lot of the minds are, of course, are been twisted just a little bit by the Atlanta experience. And, these next two guys, in particular, I mean, they've not only been twisted by the Atlanta experience, they've recently had neurosurgery in Gwinnett County. I'd like you to welcome the comedy team who opened recently for Billy Ocean, the comedy team of Pinsky and Gray.
Grant Turner,
ladies and gentlemen, give it to him. Ah. Thank you, Grant. Thank you. Oh, this is great.
Exciting.
Look at this.
You.
He was talking about this. No, I don't think. I think what this is one of those cheap backdrops you see in those
Japanese movies,
horror films. Let's do one. Come on. Wouldn't you one time like to see some monsters going like this?
It could be fun.
You're sick. Thank you.
Anyway,
thank you very much. You really are.
The reason why it's so exciting is because you got the cameras here. The lights are really bright.
I don't think they're bright enough. This cornea is not quite burned out yet. Could you turn up those?
It gives us that New York Broadway audition feeling.
Really? We'd like to take you now to New York City to the Broadway audition for Romeo and Juliet. Number 715, just step up the microphone. Tell us your name.
William Robert.
William Robert?
Well, you can shorten it to Billy Bob if you want.
Oh, okay. Billy Bob, welcome to Broadway. Where are you from?
Snellville.
What's Snellville?
It's an old Indian word meaning trailer park.
Okay. What state is that in?
Georgia.
It's probably close to Atlanta.
Pretty close. Spitting distance.
Okay.
Speaking of spit, you want some snuff?
No.
About some red man?
No, we just ate. Never mind.
Okay.
So, what brings you to Broadway?
A tractor.
I don't think you
understand. With a gun rack.
Never mind.
Okay.
Do you have any play experience?
I did a play this past year back in my school in Snellville.
What university?
Well, it weren't one.
Wait a sec. You look much too old to be in high school.
Well, it wasn't.
Oh, well.
Elementary.
Oh. That's a horse of a different color. Never mind.
Okay.
What part are you going to be trying out for?
Juliet.
Oh, no, that's the female lead.
Well, why
don't you just try out for the male lead?
You mean Romeo?
No. No, it's pronounced Romeo.
Nice horse of a different color.
Huh?
Never mind.
Okay. Wait, that's backwards. Look, I'm going to give you a scene to act out. You act out the scene.
Alrighty.
The scene is the death scene.
The death scene.
Very important.
Yeah.
Juliet comes into the crypt where you lay in state. She thinks you're dead.
Damn.
But you're not dead.
Good.
Okay.
Damn good.
Yeah, right, yeah. But she thinks you're dead.
Right.
She loves you so much, she kills herself.
That's drastic.
Yeah?
PMS, right?
Oh. Gee, we're not really sure. Shakespeare didn't put it in the cliff notes.
Ow.
Okay. It doesn't matter.
No, it don't.
You wake up.
Right.
You realize she's dead. You can't live without her. You decide to kill yourself.
Hold on, that's stupid. I wouldn't do a crazy thing like that.
I'm not asking.
There's other fishies back in Snellville.
Yeah?
I've got cousins I haven't even dated yet.
Whoa.
I'll try chorus line.
Okay, thanks. Next.
Number 720, just step up to the microphone and tell us your name, please.
Elijah Muhammad. But my given name is George Washington Lincoln Continental. If you want, you can call me Cleotis. That'd be fine.
Well, Cleotis, you know why you're here today.
Yeah, the taxi cab I'm driving is broke down out here on 42nd Street. Can I use your phone?
This is an audition.
Say what?
You just stepped into an audition.
I stepped in what? Oh, geez. I didn't see nothing on the way in. No, I need a phone. I have to call my wife, Lucille. She's home cooking dinner, and she told me if I was late this time, she was going to beat me white. I don't want to make her angry. She's a big woman. I say big. She can make that refrigerator boy look like Webster. She big-boned is what she is.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's all fine and well, but this is Romeo and Juliet, so what we'd like...
Say what?
This is Romeo and Juliet.
What's that?
Shakespeare.
Oh, that Willie dude. Yeah. I know him. Yeah. We used to hang together over on 148th Street.
No. Shakespeare's dead.
I didn't do it. I got an alibi. I don't know what day he died, but I was busy that day. Yeah. I think about it. I'm sure of it now.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's all fine and well. We're going to feed you a line from the play. We want you to spit it right back out.
You want me to throw up on you, man? Y'all sound like y'all some kinky dudes around here. Hey, you ain't going to tie me up, are you?
No, we're not going to tie you up.
Well, good, because I don't get into that freaky love. Nuh-uh. No. But check it out. My wife, Lucille, likes it a lot. A big woman like her, she'll break regular rope. She can snap rope like it was twine. I have to go down to the hardware store and get one of them nylon ropes, yellow or red, because she likes colors and everything. But like a nylon rope with a big metal hook on the end, that'll hold her butt down, yes. Say, man, it got dark all of a sudden. What's going on? Thank you. Anyway, thank God for editing machine. You know what I mean? But I ain't bragging or nothing, but last night I did something to her, and it made her shoot a hip out, and she broke the bedside lamp with it. I fixed it with super glue.
You mean the lamp?
That too, yeah.
Juliet, wherefore art thou?
Hell, I don't know. I just got here. Can I use your phone?
No, that's the line I want you to do. Juliet, wherefore art thou?
Oh, act out that line.
That's right.
Oh, I could do that, yeah. Yo, Juliet! Where your buddy is? Woman, bring it down here right now!
Romeo and Juliet.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Woo! Go.
Thank you.
This is an ad for a scary movie you might see any holiday season.
Yeah.
First, there was Jaws.
Na-na-na.
Then came Cujo. Later came Alien. And now, just when you thought it was safe to eat a holiday feast, Gobble Gobble Part 1 coming to a theater near you. It's the story about a crazy, mixed-up, epileptic turkey who dances like Chubby Checker and goes on a rampage after his lost turkey family.
Hey, kids, let's eat them turkey leftovers.
Mm-mm, Daddy, this drumstick tastes great.
Gobble Gobble Part 1, it'll scare the stuffing right out of you. See it soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. We got this one last bit.
This is called Great Moments in American History. I'm going to narrate, and Mark is going to pantomime. Great Moments in American History by Pinsky and Gray. Who can forget the 1800s, the pioneers, the settlers, traveling across the United States plains in their covered wagons? Brave and courageous those settlers be, going 100, 150 miles per hour. Searching for peace, freedom, independence, whipping their horses into a frenzy, and their kids in the back who kept saying, "Are we there yet, Daddy? I got a wee-wee." And there were Indians back then, great Indian leaders like Chief Sitting Bull and Chief Crazy Horse. Well, the Indians would circle the covered wagons and shoot their bow and arrows, and later they'd celebrate their victories and hunt buffalo and share peace pipes. Then came those cowboys. The Dallas Cowboys. There was Roger Staubach, Tony Dorsett, Herschel Walker. Well, the Cowboys fought the Indians fought the Cowboys had fast draws with one another. And then the Old West died out. A monumental decision occurred. Lincoln freed the slaves. We remember that well. And into the 20th century we came, the Roaring Twenties. There were dances with great places named after them, like the Charleston, the Texas Two-Step, the Smyrna Shuffle. Then came the Great Depression of the 1920s. The Depression occurred during the Hoover era. We remember that well. For in the Great Depression, there were long bread lines, and there were long fruit lines, and then... Then we came right smack into World War II, WW2. Who can forget WW2? So many countries involved in WW2. That's two wars in one. There were the British. There were the Russians, the Italians. The Italian women. There were planes, there were tanks, and there were bombs. Horror because of Hiroshima. Horror because of Nagasaki. Barry Manilow was born. There was VE Day victory in Europe, VJ Day victory in Japan, and of course VD Day because the soldiers returned. And then the war ended, and years of prosperity came about. The baby boom generation was now upon us. Babies popped up from everywhere. A baby here, a baby there, a baby everywhere. Right smack in the 1960s, the drug-filled 60s. Campus students shooting dope, or trying to shoot dope, but... With the 60s came musical heroes, musical idols to cherish and by God look up to. Janis Joplin. Jimi Hendrix. Jim Morrison. Mama Cass. The Who. The Guess Who. The Vietnam War. Pot and hand grenades and pot, we remember. Then came the Richard Nixon era. Then came the Gerald Ford era. And soon it'll be 1988. Who might our next president be? Ted Kennedy? Nab, Chappaquiddick. Thank you very much. We're Pinsky and Gray. My partner, Mark Ray.
Mr. Daryl Pinsky.
Y'all been super.
Thank you.
Right. Right. You guys are up. You're ready. And I got something else to tell you, too. I don't want to blow my own horn, but recently, I was in Chattanooga. Chattanooga. I mean, is that a town that we never think of?
Yes.
It's something, it's up there and you just never think of it. It never comes up. But if you're up there, you're driving around, you see the signs, you can't help but say this. You say it in your, you know, your head, you're Chattanooga. And you can't help but automatically have that echo in the back of your head when you say it says, chee-chee. You ever notice that? Grown men, you're driving around going, chee-chee. Chattanooga, it's fun to say. Do you ever say it to yourself? Just Chattanooga. Say it with me. Chattanooga. Chee-chee. See, you can't help it. And if you say it often enough, it doesn't mean anything after a while, does it? Chattanooga, 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 Chattanooga. Actually, I think it's an old Cherokee Indian word. It means Sea Rock City. All right. Well, the next guy you're going to meet, I've known him for 5 years. I've known him for 5 years, and he's still a child. He's very funny. He's still a child. You're going to love him. He recently just, he started a movie called The Cursor. Please welcome to the stage. You've seen him before. J. Anthony Brown. Yeah.
Woo! Woo, woo, woo. All right. Say hey! Say who? Boy, you white folks, all right, boy, I'll tell you. How you doing? How you doing? Go ahead, you can touch a black man, it's all right. There you go. Look at you, yeah, felt pretty good, didn't it, huh? Had a drink, touched a black man, hot damn it, you're ready to go home, aren't you? Just more fun than you wanted to have. You're a good crowd, you really are. Let's start it off right from the top. The Pillsbury Doughboy pisses me off, he really does. I'd like to eat him, I really would, huh? Oh, I don't mean spread his legs and go down. Now, wait a minute. I'd like to snatch his butt right off that damn counter, huh? Yeah, just glaze him down with butter, right? Slap him in the oven, preheated at 365. I'd wipe that damn smile off his face, huh? Smile now, sucker! Yeah, because these commercials and such are intelligence. They really do. You've seen them. You hate them. Kibbles and bits and kibbles and bits. I'd like to drop kick that dog across the parking lot, wouldn't you? Greyhound. Now, Greyhound has been using the same advertisement for years. Same slogan, hadn't changed. Ride the bus and leave the driving to us. Go Greyhound and leave the driving to us. Isn't that stupid as hell? Like, who in the hell else they think gonna drive, right? I mean, they don't think you're gonna buy a ticket and drive the damn bus too, right? Wouldn't that be weird? You get on the bus and they divide up the driving or something like that? Okay, little girl, you'll drive for 10 minutes. And the old lady will take 15. And then the blind man will take us on in. Then you go in the restroom. You go in the restroom, there's a sign over the sink that says, please do not drink the bus water. Like, who in the hell drinks bus water, right? Can you see somebody flagging a bus down like, shh, oh, I'm not going anywhere. No, I just want to get some of that delicious bus water you got there. Have you heard this commercial on the radio about these people who are eating Spam, but they don't know it? You can smell that stuff a mile away. You could be in a club dancing, having a good time. Somebody pop up a can of that stuff in the parking lot. You'd pick it up, you really would. You never, Somebody in Spam right now? What the hell? And these clowns don't know it. Is that Spam? I thought it was a Snickers bar. Get your butt out of here, man. See, the problem is that they're picking the wrong people, right? See, I'd love to be in a Spam commercial. Oh, I'd pay money. I'm like, what the hell's that? Spam, man? What's your damn problem, buddy? What the hell's wrong with you, man? Damn it, Spam is in there. Well, give me some bus water to wash that down. You ever watch small kids drink water? You ever watch them? And we always rush them, right? Hurry up and drink that damn water! I like like to watch you ladies who can't deal with your kids. You're a lot of fun, man. You ever see these ladies in the malls and stuff like that making a fool out of themselves? You ever see them? Don't they piss you off? Like, don't they? They're going, Mildred, you're testing me. You're testing me. Come on, I'll test your butt, all right. See, I came from the old school. The rules were simple. If you got out of line, you got it on the spot, right? My mother was like, hey, come here. Stand right here. Hold your lips up here. Now get outside and play. And it's weird, too, because you hear people give reasons as to why they had kids. They say, yeah, we had a kid so we can watch him grow, send him to school, college, add to the family. That's a bunch of bull. People have kids for one reason and one reason only. So they don't have somebody to go get stuff they don't feel like getting up off their butts to go get the damn thing. You got kids, you run them ragged, right? You'll call a kid in from across town. Come here. Hurry up. Come here. Hand me those cigarettes right there. And see, kids are great. Kids use emotions that when we grow up, we forget about. They whine. You ever watch small kids whine? Now, that's the thing. They love to whine. Mildred, sit down. I don't want to sit down. And throw their head back like it's going to fall off. Here's a killer right here. Wouldn't that be great if we could still whine? Wouldn't that be nice? Like, I'm sorry, Ralph. I know tomorrow's your off day, but we're kind of short-handed and we need you to come in. I don't want to come in. I want to be off. Yeah, that'll be great to try it out on your lady, wouldn't it? Like, not tonight, Ralph. I got a headache. I want to do it. Time for me to get out of here, but I want to sing a song I wrote a couple of years ago. And it's a country western song, and all the black people going, it better be funny. Oh, you gotta kind of loosen up for this. I don't know if this will work. Oh, look at it. See, you put a cowboy hat on, they start making that noise. They, woo! The name of the song is I'm a Black Man and I Like Country Western Music Too. It's original. Everybody clap your hands. Here we go. Come on. Woo! All right, here we go. All right. Hey. Ever since I can remember, come on, and I'm 30 years old today, whoo! A heavy soul music with a real funky beat was the only kind I would play. You know, Gladys and Jackie and JB and the Timps, you might not believe that it's true. Hey, but I'm a black man, and I like country western music too. Oh, lady, lady, oh, lady, oh, lady, 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 yeah. Well, it started out as a joke. I tried to get myself some privacy. I turned my radio on a country western station, and it sounded kind of good to me. Well, I ain't too proud to admit it. And I ain't handing you no, hey, cause I'm a black man and I like country western music too. Oh, lady, lady, oh, lady, oh, lady, lady. Last verse. Well, now my story's out. I hope the brothers, they don't get mad. They try to run me down or beat me up or even set fire to my pad. Well, I ain't too proud to admit it. And I ain't handing you no head, cause I'm a black man and I like country western music too. Oh, lady, lady, come on. One more time. Oh, lady, lady, oh, lady, oh, lady, lady. Thank you, you've been wonderful. Thank you.
I was going to tell you this earlier about fashion, and I just want to tell you that it's good to look out and see people that know how to dress. Oh, because, you know, the people in L.A., they're just overly trendy dressed people. I mean, they're just, just awful. The women are the worst with the, what they call them, those stretch cotton pants that came out like a year ago. You know, they abuse those things. You ever seen that? I don't know, they make their panty lines look like small irrigation ditches. Just, oh, and they always have their high heel, some high heel shoe happening, you know, just really jacked them to the back like a 71 Torino walking around. There it is. Just get it up in the air. That's the idea. Take a look at that differential if you want. Because they always have their hair moosed up in some sort of antler formation, you know? You can't tell who's a hooker and who's just dropping off film. You don't know. Well, we got another born and bred Atlanta guy coming up here. He was a winner of the 1985 Great Southeastern Laugh-Off and the winner of the 1986 Pepsi Laugh-Off in Nashville, Tennessee. Please welcome to the stage, Mr. Jeff Foxworthy.
Grant Turner. Thank you. Thank you. Nice to be back home. I love it here in Atlanta. I've been all over the country. I think we have the greatest city in the country right here in Atlanta. We do? We do. We have wonderful people here. We have beautiful women here. I would, however, like to get a couple of joints out of whatever the guys were smoking that designed our street systems here, though, boys. All right, Julio, I got this great idea. See, we'll loop this thing around real big like that. Put a dead end right there at the end of it, sucker. All right, now listen, when it gets dark, I want you to go get some exits and just move them, all right? Move them. What is that, Roswell Road? All right, we'll buy about 2 billion red lights, put them about every 10 foot down that sucker. No, dude, no need to paint lines on the street. They don't use them here anyway, man. And we're nice people, but we are some of the shittiest drivers in the entire world, boy. I think in Atlanta, traffic lights are merely a suggestion at this point. I'm serious, you'll see somebody sitting at a red light in the right-hand lane going, hold on, baby, because soon as this sumbitch turns green, we're going to make a left-hand turn here. I don't know how in the hell they know when anybody's drunk driving. I swear I don't. See, and that's a big deal now. It's if you're out drinking, like everybody is, they want you to take along somebody that's not drinking, you know, to be a designated driver. How many of you are designated drivers? Got like 5 in the whole room, boy. Everybody else is staring at me like, hell, Jeff, why the hell get drunk if you ain't gonna drive? That's half the fun of being shit-faced, boy. You see all those headlights coming at you, trying to figure out which two's the real one. And I'm not putting down designated drivers, I'm not. But you guys that have got stuck with it, see, have some fun with it, see? Because you're sober, and basically you're just babysitting people whose biggest ambition is to pee in the parking lot or something. Have some fun with them. At the end of the night, drop them off at the wrong damn house. Preferably in their boss's front yard or something. Where the hell are my flamingos at? And you can make money on them, too. Drunks will give you money for anything. What you do, get a carload of them. On the way home, stop at every gas station you come to. Get out, pretend like you're putting gas in the car, make them pay for a full damn tank. You make $400 or $500 in a 10-mile stretch there. Damn, Bill, the mileage on this thing sucks, I swear. And it can happen to anybody, I mean, these things. I mean, one time it happened to my dad. I was a little kid, and my dad was on the front seat, you know, I was on the front seat of the car, and my dad had been drinking all day long, and we got pulled over by the state patrol, and the officer walked up to Dad's window, and he goes, excuse me there, sir. Could I see your license, please? No, sir, I don't need a cold one. I don't think you do either. Mr. Foxworthy, do you know why I pulled you over, sir? Well, it concerns that vehicle you're pulling behind you. No, sir, it's not against the law to tow a boat, but state law does require that you put that boat on a trailer. Could you ask your friends to get out of the boat, please, sir? No, sir, I don't give a damn if the fish are biting. Could you ask your friends to get out of the boat there? See, and everybody thinks DUI is alcohol. DUI is driving under the influence. And that can be under the influence of a lot of things. You can have driving under the influence of marijuana. These people are usually pretty easy to spot. They're driving about 3 miles an hour and trying to eat the upholstery.
You can have driving under the influence of cocaine. These guys are driving about 200 miles an hour and talking to the upholstery. I bet your daddy used to be a nogahide, didn't he? You can have driving under the influence of quaaludes, or better known as illegal parking. They just think they're driving. And the most deadly driver of all, you have to watch out for this killer on our roads, the guy that's driving under the influence of oral sex. Whoa! That's happened to him, boy. Red as hell, boys. What else? See, now, recently got married. That's kind of neat. But there's things I don't understand, see? It's like I don't understand, like, how I can wake up in the morning, take a shower, get dressed, be ready to walk out the door in 25 or 30 minutes. I come home at night. We get ready to go out somewhere. This girl spends 3 hours trying to get her hair to do things God never intended hair to do. I've gone so far as to bring in one of those television evangelists, lifeless devil, come out. Feel the power of hairspray. She spends 4 days in front of the makeup mirror trying to paint her face with a little brush with four hairs in it. I'm going, Jesus Christ, use a roller, let's go. Changes clothes 1,500 times and then stomps into the living room and goes, I'm not going, I look like shit. People point at each other. Well, they do this. Then they get right in your face and go, tell me I look like shit. There ain't no way I'm telling you that, no. And what do you do, guys? You can't win. Because if you disagree with them and tell them they're pretty, they call you a liar. And if you agree with them, you live the sex life of a monk till Christmas. You know, and she'll throw fits, you know. She'll say things like, she goes, I can't do anything with my hair, and I got these zits you can't even see. My sister got all the tits, and my thighs look like cottage cheese. And how come you never tell me I'm pretty anymore? Hell, you just describe yourself. You're a troll. Well, see, men just don't care as much, do we? I mean, you'll never see, like, a man picking up his buddy to go fishing at 5 o'clock in the morning going, damn, Bill, you ain't gonna wear that shirt with them shoes, are you? It's after Labor Day, for crying out loud. Think that jacket would look better belted. You should do that. We don't even care if we're getting fat, you know? We'll get fat. You never see a guy at a bowling alley going, Chuck, you think I'm getting fat? I'm serious. Watch my butt when I bowl. Tell me if it jiggles. Would you do that for me? Would you watch my butt for me? Well, guys, before I get out of here, how many of you had a chance to go out last weekend and catch the Metro Atlanta Spelling Bee? How many of you saw? Well, you're lying, because I just made this shit up. But for those of you that didn't see it, it's okay, because I'm going to recap the three finalists for you right now. My name is Willie Albachilli. I go to Holy Ghost High School. I would now like to properly spell you a word and use that word geogrammatically correct in a sentence. My word is schedule. S-C-H-E-D-U-L-E, schedule. I bet if you ever saw a ghost that scared you so bad, you shit in your pants. My name's Deborah P. Mason. I go to Fairburn High School. I want to spell you a word they learned me in school. Indicator, I-N-D-I-C-A-T-O-R, indicator. My brother-in-law Bubba lives way out, indicator. scares the shit out of my dad, I swear it does. My name is Rex. I go to Midtown High School. I'm gonna spell you a fabulous word. I hope you like it a lot and everything and all. My word is indifferent. I-N-D-I-F-F-E-R-E-N-T, indifferent. Out of all the guys to go out with, Butch is the only one that puts it indifferent.
Thank you very much, guys. Enjoy the rest of the show.
I'd like to introduce you to another Atlanta guy. He grew up right here, and he's all over the television doing commercials, and he just recently finished a pilot, a television sitcom pilot called Dick and Tracy. Please, welcome to the stage, Mr. Rob Cleveland. Yeah.
Wow, wow. All right, I'm excited now. Here we go. Beautiful, oh, gosh, night, wonderful Atlanta, Georgia, room full of white folks. My God, I'm a happy Negro. Yeah, I see you black people sitting up front. Easy as hell to spot you in here tonight. Like finding raisins in a bowl of grits, you know what I'm saying? It's a fun job I have being a comic. I love this job. This is a great job. And I know, I've had crappy jobs. Best job I ever had, though, senior year in college, I contributed to a sperm bank. What the hell y'all looking at? This is a damn good job. Couldn't beat it. Well, then I guess you could. Well, hell, there was a lot of stiff competition for this job. It was a great job. They paid $75 a whack load thing. I knew there was a name, and I knew you'd know. I hate flying, because they tell you stupid stuff on planes. You hop on a plane, what's the first thing they tell you? In case of a sudden loss of cabin pressure, loosely translated, ain't no air on the plane. An oxygen mask will drop from the ceiling, place it on your face. No shit. You can't breathe, can't figure out where to put an oxygen mask, your ass needs to die. But then they tell you, place it on your face, take the rubber strap provided. Ooh, thank God, I always forget to bring mine. Place it on your face and continue to breathe in a what?
Normal.
Normal. Normal. I think we know what the word normal means. You got a hunk of plastic on your face, sitting in a 727 with no air in it, heading at a mountain at 2,000 miles an hour. The time for breathing normally is gone. Bye-bye. It's time to be screaming and peeing on yourself. I'm gonna be easy to find. Then they make you feel even better. In case of an emergency landing, ooh, your seat cushion, ooh, ooh, can be used as a flotation device. Hot damn, I'm feeling safe. I hope they give you an outboard motor for this thing. It's the last time you saw on the news that flotilla of seats coming in from the Atlantic Ocean. I got in trouble on a plane. I got in trouble because I'm a man. I mean, let's face it, God did ugly things to us men. We have hair in our face and nipples for no apparent reason. I was sitting next to a woman, gorgeous looking lady, holding a cute little baby in her arms. In the middle of our conversation, she commences to nurse her baby without even an excuse me, do you mind while I pull my tit out? I mean, if I'm gonna pee in her drink, I'm gonna ask first. And don't get me wrong, ladies, I think nursing a baby is very wonderful, very beautiful, very natural, except for three things. I'm male, I'm single, I'm slime. I can't concentrate and talk to this woman when 2 inches from my head is this baby going. I'm praying like hell we don't hit turbulence. Child will have a concussion. Flight attendant picks that time to wheel her cart down the aisle, tap me on the shoulder, ask me if I want something to drink. I'm male, I'm single, I'm slime. All I could think of was, no, 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 I'll just have some of what the kid's having. And men, if you have friends that have babies that are nursing, do not hold this child. They love to give you this baby to hold. It's a practical joke to them. You know what I'm talking about? The baby doesn't know your tit from the mother's tit. You're sitting there holding the baby, rocking it, grooving it, yeah, okay. Hey, hey, hey! I got a situation over here! And the baby's looking at you like... Hey, I'm hungry. Give out with the milk or I'm peeing on you. You can kiss them leather pants goodbye. Yeah. You tour around a lot, you can't have pets. I miss having a pet. Pets are great to have, but if you're gonna get a pet, get a real one. Don't get fish. Fish suck. Fish are only fun to have if you forget to feed them. You know what happens? You come home late and you open the door, they're all at the side of the tank. Where the hell you been? Now don't look for the guppies. We ate that shit about an hour ago. Your cat's in the corner. Feed the fish, damn it! That goldfish is on the side of the tank going, here, kitty, 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 kitty. If you are gonna get a dog, get a real one. Don't get a little dog. Anything under 40 pounds is not a dog. It's a gerbil on steroids. Anyway, gotta leave this last little bit for you about dog I saw in the Humane Society, a black Labrador retriever. I was gonna get him, but somebody else bought him. So I wrote this little bit about him, and please don't let the kids try this at home. I am a trained professional. They could kill themselves. Yeah, these are great to have. You ever pull over by the cops late at night? Just hop out on all fours. Yes, officer, we seem to be the trouble. All right. Me and the black lab. How much is that doggy in the window? The what? Hey, you, Shih Tzu, get the hell away from my dish. I'm trying to get adopted in here, man. You two guys. Come here, man. You looking for a dog? Check me out. Black lab, ain't nothing better than the pound. Say what? A French poodle. I can do that too. Arf, arf, monsieur. Bonsoir up your butt. Well, hell, I don't want to go home with him no way. Besides, I ain't supposed to be in here. Last family said they had to put me in here because I kept peeing on their sofa. That's a lie, man. They had a two-year-old. He was always peeing on stuff. I get blamed for it. Should have ate that little son of a bitch when I had the chance. Size, I ain't going to be doing this too much longer. I'm going to be on David Letterman's Stupid Pet Tricks next week. Sing a little song I wrote. Always helps me get adopted. Now, look, I need your help on this song. Now, when I say now, and I know it's a lot to ask of a predominantly white crowd, but could you try to clap in time to the music? If you're sitting near black people, follow them, they should be on beat. It's a lovely little song, I think you'll recognize it. It goes something like this. I thought pounds were only meant for other dogs, meant for curs without a pedigree. Not yet! But they were out to get me. Said I was a butt. Now I'm doing time here on my butt. Can't you see my face? Hey, I'm a retriever. All I do is chase. I don't even know why. It's my job. I'm a retriever. I'll swim like a beaver till the day I die. Throw me a newspaper and I'll fetch it. I'll chew it up and bring it back to you. I won't lick my balls in public, not even if they itch. I'm not your average mongrel son of a bitch. Now, no, I'm not a mutt. No, I'm a retriever. Don't you see this tennis ball in my mouth? No, I'm not a mutt. No! I'm a retriever. I'll swim like that beaver till the day I die. Dance break. They say that I'm part collie, mixed with basset hound. Now I'm doing time here in the pound. No, I'm not a mutt. No, I'm a retriever. Don't you see that tennis
just fall in my mouth. Don't drive drunk. No, I'm not a butt. I'm a retriever. I'll squirt like that beaver till the day I die. You guys have been a lot of fun. Take good care. Bye-bye.
You know, I was back at the back bar earlier, and the people were walking by, and I realized what it is about the South that I miss the most. I mean, it just came to me. I mean, it's not the gnats. I mean, we don't sit around, you know, in California going, you know, I wish we had some gnats. I haven't pulled anything wonderful out of my nose in about a year. It's the women, the Southern women. I mean, let me tell you, there's no other creature like a Southern woman on the earth. I mean, they're just a unique breed. You just won't find people that will walk up to other people unsolicited, you know, out of the blue, to total strangers and go, well, hey, how are you? It's so good to see you. Were you in my speech class at school? Yeah, the Tar Heel, Carolina Blue. All right. All right, you ready for your next talented man? All right, let me just say this guy is not originally from Atlanta, but don't judge him based on that. I mean, he's originally from Daytona, Florida. I know. But he likes Atlanta. He's now basing himself out of Atlanta. You've probably heard him on 96 Rock many, many times. He just recently opened for Laura Branigan. Please welcome to the stage, Mr. Louis Nixon.
Thanks, Grant. Great to be back in Atlanta. Great to be anywhere this week. I just came from Florida. Guys, when you're down there, don't go to a topless beach in Florida. It's not what you think. We went, we thought we'd be cool, hang out, babes come walking by, nothing on top. It's not like that. It's old retired ladies from New York. Yeah, you look down at the sand, you'll see footprints and nipple drag marks on either side going all the way down that beach. Just trying to help you out. It's an ugly, ugly thing. All leathery. Been on the road a lot. Watch a lot of cable. You know what? Cable's not important for the new shows that are coming on. It's important because all of us need to go back and watch the reruns of the shows we grew up on. The writers were sliding a few in our parents weren't picking up on. Like this Leave it to Beaver. You've seen it. It's disgusting. Eddie Haskell comes over to see Wally. June lets him in. Eddie says, hey, Wally, let's go see a movie. And Wally says, and this is a quote, Wally says, gee, Eddie, I can't. Mom and Dad want me to go looking for Beaver. The writers are in the green room smoking a joint, laughing their asses off. They got this on TV 20 years ago. A couple weeks later, Wally comes running down the stairs. He says, Mom, Dad, better come upstairs quick. Something's eating the beef. It's on regular TV. We watch this crap. We watched a show called Green Acres. You remember that? Here we have a knowledgeable, well-educated attorney from New York City. Decides to trash everything and move into a shit shack in Hooterville, huh? Beautiful wife standing at the door of the shack, Oliver! He's out plowing the field with a three-piece suit on. Nothing wrong with this guy. Then Hank Kimball shows up. Morning, Mr. Douglas. Well, it's not a great morning. Well, it's not a bad morning either. Make up your mind, you idiot Nimrod. By the time we recover from this guy, Mr. Haney shows up to sell you something. Mr. Douglas. I am here to offer you this genuine fur coat for the measly sum of $18.67. Thanks, Mom and Dad, for letting me watch this crap on TV. Sister show to that, Petticoat Junction, remember that? Come and ride a little train that's rolling down the tracks to the junction. Good job. My favorite line of the opening of that show, and there's Uncle Joe. He's moving kind of slow. You see, the last three episodes, he was dead. He didn't move at all. Benji was pulling at his pants leg the whole time. And if you watch the rest of that intro, they put you on a train, you come around the track, what's the first thing you saw when you got to the junction, remember? Water tower. Girls are up there in a water tower. Petticoats are over the side. It's the town's drinking water. Come on. Gonna drink that water? I would. I'd have been bottling that water if I'd known what was going on. Hi, I'm Frank Bartles. My partner Ed and I have come up with something you will not believe. But we can't talk about it on prime time. So we ain't gonna get on. Oh, got cartoon fans here? Yeah? My favorite cartoon of all time, and I hope one of yours, The Underdog Show. Da 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 da. It's The Underdog Show!
Help! Help, help! Help! Help, help!
When Sweet Polly's in trouble, I am not slow. It's hip, 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 and away I go. All right, Underdog. I've got Sweet Polly purebred. And you won't get her back till I rule the world. In the secret compartment of my ring, I fill with Sweet Polly Purebred's birth control pill. Something like that. They changed it up. Is it wrong to pull your eyes back when you're eating Chinese food? Is it wrong to jerk on Junior just because you're in the mood? Is it wrong to sprinkle sand in your sister's Vaseline? No. Is it wrong for Ernest Borgnine to go out on Halloween? No. Is it wrong for Richard Simmons to claim to be a man? No. Is it wrong to hire spelunkers to find your girlfriend's diaphragm? Is it wrong to ask Mel Tillis to say the Gettysburg Address? Is it wrong to eat raw oysters while you watch your wife undress? Is it wrong to post gale warnings after lunch at Taco Bell? Is it wrong to tell Sean Penn that Madonna looks like hell? Is it wrong to tell your children that Dick Clark may never die? Is it wrong to find a cyclops and poke him in the eye? Is it wrong to leave your butt print on the bathroom shower tiles? Is it wrong to give a wedgie to a friend who's got the piles? Is it wrong for two bisexuals to go down a one-way street? Is it wrong to ask your butcher if he ever beats his meat? Is it wrong to ask J.L. Kraft if he ever cut the cheese? Is it wrong to ask Hugh Hefner if it burns him when he pees? You're a sick crowd. A sick bunch of people. Sick bunch of people. Great being back in Atlanta. The first time I came here, I came dangerously close to an area called Snellville. I didn't go in. I just looked in from the road. They do drive a certain type of transportation in Snellville. Damn it, they drive them proud. I want to dedicate this next piece to anybody from Snellville. Anybody that knows anybody from Snellville. Anybody that's ever gotten really drunk and accidentally stumbled into Snellville. Or anybody else that drives a pickup truck. This is for you. I want a new truck. Want a truck, it's blue. Want a truck with great big tires. Want a truck with a gun rack, too. I want a new truck. Runs good when it's full. Want a truck, make my family proud. Next month in the tractor pull. A truck, it don't need much service. That temperature gauge stays cool. A truck, it sits high in the air and runs on regular fuel. It runs on regular fuel. I want a new truck.
with a dual exhaust. Want a truck with a spotlight too, in case my pigs get lost. I want a new truck, and I want one Zip. I want a truck Cousin Sue can drive after we get hitched in June. I want a truck that don't need much service, that old temperature gauge stays cool. A truck that sits high in the R and runs on regular fuel. Runs on regular fuel. Runs on regular fuel. Hell yeah. I want a new truck. Want a truck gets a horse. Want a truck gets lots of stairs every year in the cow chip toss. I want a new truck. One for me and the boys. We want a truck with a soundproof cab, case the sheep make too much noise. A truck that don't need much service, that old temperature gauge stays cool. A truck, it sits high in the air and runs on regular fuel. It runs on regular fuel. You guys have been great. Enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you.
Louis Nixon. I'm going to bring the next guy right up. He's originally from Columbus, Georgia. He got his start right here at the Punchline, and now he's a regular at the Improv in New York City. You're gonna like this guy, very unique, man. Please welcome to the stage, put your hands in each other's laps, and welcome out the comedy of Mr. Tim Wilson. Yes.
All right. How y'all doing? Good moods? Well, getting the good moods. Good to be back in Atlanta. I'm originally from Columbus, Georgia. Obviously got kind of a southern accent. I was originally born in Brooklyn, moved south the next day. Right? Southern folks have the reputation for being a little less than brilliant. The British send us culture, right? Culture Club with Boy George, right? You know, I'm a man without conviction. I'm going, George, I'll take you to South Georgia. I'll get you a conviction. Well, I don't want to say George is a $3 bill, but he's close to a Susan B. Anthony. I'll give you that. If I looked like that, I'd do heroin too. You know? Yeah. Maybe he'll OD and give us all a damn break. You know? Them old Baptist beers are starting to kick in over here. How many of y'all got relatives in here? My daddy had 10 kids in his family when he was growing up. We always have to go to those family reunion holiday things. You know those? Like Thanksgiving, Christmas, you go to one of your aunt's house. She's invited everybody you ever knew in your life to eat dinner, right? You show up, the old women walk out and go, "Oh, you've gotten so big. How are you doing? Oh, you know me, don't you?" "No, ma'am, I don't." "No." "Oh, yes, you do. You know me. I used to change your diapers for you when you were 2 years old." "Yes, ma'am, I remember you now." "You still got the old flab under the arms there." "Yes, ma'am. You're getting big, too." Right? So all the women have to go into the kitchen to cook, right? There's one woman cooking. The rest of them are just acting like they're cooking, right? It's like, "Well, I've never put that in a casserole before." "Well, you ought to." "Well, I think I will." "Well, you ought to. That way your casserole won't taste like shit next time we come over to your house."
Well, I think I will. Well, you ought to. Huh?
All the guys have to go into the living room and watch football, right? It's their job, right? Yeah. Half of them don't know anything about football. They're coaching today, right? It's like that boy right there sucks. He sucks. How come they don't put old Johnny Unitas in the ball game? Oh, he ain't playing this year? Well, I ain't kept up with it this year, you know. Yeah, Uncle Fred, they got a new thing called face mask now, which is catching on, you know. Face mask? Hell, I got a bunch of sissies out there playing ball now. I got my nose broke 114 times playing ball. You know, well, maybe that's why you talk like you do, you know. Then you have to set the table, right?
It's like, well, Edna and Louise can sit right here. Fred and Barbara, y'all come on right here and sit right here. And where is Charles and Laura? Oh, they ain't got here yet. Well, we'll just wait on them.
They show up an hour later going, we'd have called y'all if we'd known we was going to be late. We didn't know, you know.
Well, you ought to.
So then you have to get out those tray tables for the kids. Take off somewhere else to eat. You know what I'm talking about? Can't sit with the parents. Got to take a tray table, go out in the damn yard somewhere. Yeah. Hey, I'm 25 years old. I still have to take a tray table and go out in the yard somewhere to eat. No. I'm hoping one of those ants will die so I can sit at the table next year, you know, but they don't. They just get older. And they always put you out there like your second cousin. He's 6 years old. You got to think of something to talk to this fool about, you know. I've been through 4 years of college. I'm out here going, He-Man and the Masters of the Universe? Yeah, I know that. So then you have to say the blessing, which is the most tense time of the day, right? Everybody gets real tense. And it's like, dear God, please don't make me have to say the blessing, you know.
She'll go, Tim, would you like to say the blessing?
You know, no, ma'am. You know, God knows we're thankful. And if I did say the blessing, I'd have to scream the thing because I'm out in the yard somewhere, you know. There's different kind of blessing sayers. There's those that have said the same one so many times, they talk so fast, it sounds like they're speaking in tongues. You know, it's like, dear God, blah, 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 amen. You know, my granddaddy used to slap us and go, God don't want to hear that shit, start over, you know. Old God's a creative God. He wants you to be creative, too. Don't start that nourishment of our bodies crap, either. You done heard that a million times. Yeah, I know nourishment of our bodies. Hell, Charles' wife weighs 360. She don't need no more nourishment, you know? So you go through eating everything. Some of the women will get together in the kitchen. They'll go, let me help y'all with those dishes.
No, that's all right. We'll take care of them. Don't worry about it. No, I'm going to help y'all with those dishes.
No, you're not. You go on in there and sit down. She'll go sit down. They'll go, that bitch, she don't never work, you know? And some of the women have brought stuff and they don't want to have to take back home with them. Got to pawn it off on you. Like 2 hours later, they're here going, does anybody else want any more black-eyed peas? You know, no, ma'am. We just had all we need. We sure do appreciate it.
Well, I done cooked all day now. I want y'all to finish these things up.
You know, no, ma'am.
I done cooked a 55-gallon drum of black-eyed peas. I want y'all to finish it. I'll just have to give them to the dog.
Hey, the dog's going, no, ma'am. That all we need. No.
Well, I guess I'll just throw them away. No. Well, you ought to. Right,
no. Y'all been a lot of fun. Thanks a lot.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome to the stage now. Right now. Man who, I'd like to welcome back to Atlanta, welcome back to the Punchline, the funniest man in America, welcome Mr. James Gregory.
Thank you. Thank you. Before we get into anything funny, let me tell you about the sign that's over here on Buford Highway. The sign is in the storefront. The sign says, Lawnmower Repair and Income Tax Service. Lord knows we've been needing something like that. Oh, yeah, just like how many times over the years you and I have carried our lawnmower in to get it fixed. And while we were there, we probably said to ourselves, well, damn, I'd like to get my taxes done while I'm here. Yeah. I guess they'll franchise that out now. See, you have to wonder where the guy got the idea for a business like that. Did somebody go in there one day to pick up their mower, and they said to this guy, you know, you did a hell of a job on this lawnmower. I think I'll let you do my taxes. people should laugh every day. It's good for you. The problem is you can't go out and see a comedian every night of the week. You people have got to learn to amuse yourselves. And I'm going to give you a couple of tips. Like, for instance, the next time you're the lead car in a funeral procession, make a wrong turn. Oh, what the hell? Lead everybody to a car wash. You know, get like hot wax for the bereaved. And my favorite thing, you can do this anytime. The next time you're in the supermarket, put things in other people's buggy when they're not looking. And then get behind them in the checkout line. I swear, they'll be just like this, like, well, damn, I don't remember getting that. Then they'll pay for it. And this is just for you guys out there. Any of you fellows that use a shave cream called Gillette Foamy, you can verify this when you get home. Gillette Foamy now has a warning on the can. First of all, how dangerous can anything named Foamy be? Hell, you would name your poodle Foamy. But on this shave cream, it now says, warning, keep away from open flame. You know what that means? Sometime in the past, some nut has said to his wife, honey, I think I'll sit in the fireplace to shave. Before we get too far into the show, everywhere I go, people come up to me and they say, every time I see you, you're happy, you're smiling, you're in a good mood. Why don't you ever get depressed about anything? I've learned in traveling over this great land of ours and most of the world that no matter who you meet, where they're from, what color they are, once you realize we're all equal, you feel better about everything. There's three things in this life I can't stand. Hatred, bigotry, midgets. I'm sorry, I just don't like them. You ever wanted to spray a midget with Raid to see what it would do? Yeah. You know, make it wiggle a little bit. See, here's what gets me. Think about this. Everyone in this room has seen a midget before. No one in here ever sees more than one midget at a time. You go over to the mall, there'll be thousands of people, one midget. Could be a law, I don't know. But you've never seen a daddy midget and a mama midget and a station wagon full of midget kids. If midgets never get together with other midgets, how do we keep getting more midgets? It's wearing the hell out of me. I noticed down here at that street, the poor folks restaurant, the sign out front today says, stop. Say howdy to our pork chops. Well, you know I turned around. Oh, this lady started about regular size, hungry size. I said, hell, lady, I'm not going to eat them. I want to talk to them. Get them out here. Yeah. Signs are interesting. You ever been driving through a neighborhood and you'll see a sign in somebody's front yard that says, for sale by owner. To me, that seems like a lot of wasted paint. Who else would be selling this man's house? I've never seen a sign that said, for sale by neighbor. Well, hell yeah, come on in. We'll sell it to you. They're on vacation. They'll never know. Come on, get on. Yeah. You ever met somebody for the first time in your life and you try to think of one word that best describes them, and no matter how hard you think, you keep coming back to the basic word stupid? This is a real person. He owns a comedy club up in Milwaukee. One night we was in his office before the show started, watching television. They had a commercial come on to promote a movie. They said, coming soon to a theater near you. And John said, now how in the hell do they know where I live? Scared me. I know that being average, typical Americans, every day of your life, this thought goes through your mind at least once. And that is, wonder why anybody ever wanted to be on Family Feud. I've been thinking about it. I keep visualizing some family out around Nebraska or Iowa, sitting around the dinner table one evening, and the husband says, honey, you know what? They ought to be a way that we can let this whole country know our family's illiterate. And then you end up watching them on the show, the lady introduces everybody. Now, Richard, I'd like you to meet our handsome son, Eric. That makes you sit up straight because you can see Eric's ugly. Now, later on in the show, it's Eric's turn to answer, and we all know what tough questions they have on Family Feud. By the way, you know, in Mississippi, that line won't work. It don't work here either, but you know. In Mississippi, when I say, you know what tough questions they have on Family Feud, the whole audience will be going, oh, yeah. But anyway, the question for Eric is, name one of the states that begins with the letter K. And of course, Eric is stumped on this. But just before the buzzer sounds, he says Connecticut. Am I upset with Eric? No, it's that family of his. Good answer, good answer. I tell you one good thing about television, though, the commercials are getting honest. There's one on now that tells the truth, you've heard it. It's not a car, it's a Volkswagen. Well, it's about time they fessed up on that. You know? And then, of course, they still got the stupid ones, like the one for X-Lax. We're talking about a laxative now. In this commercial, you've got this grown woman talking to her grown daughter, and they refer to X-Lax as their family's best friend. Wonder where in the hell they go for Christmas dinner. The next time that commercial is on, you listen carefully to what the man says during the commercial. He's talking about a laxative. He says, and I quote, it works while you sleep. I don't want that. Right. No, I want to be up and awake, you know. Ready to go. I miss what I call the classic TV commercials. There's one on for a long time. It was for Hot Shot Bug Spray. They had this old lady, about 75 years old, wearing a shawl, sitting in a rocking chair. And these big bugs would come around her head. These bugs were bigger than chickens. Y'all remember that? These were 20-pound bugs. Didn't even scare that old woman. Grab that hot shot, squirt one of them, and the voice in the background would say, kills bugs in midair. I don't want a 20-pound bug dying in midair. Hell, it could kill the baby. Oh, man, it's so good to be here. Those of you that's never been to Oklahoma, don't go. That's the most God-forsaken place. In my prayers at night, I say, God, just get me out of Oklahoma. And God would say, where in the hell is Oklahoma? Oh, man. I don't do any sexual or political humor, and I'll tell you why. I keep getting the two confused. I was on this TV show in New York a few weeks ago, and they asked me, they said, what do you think about the Middle East position? And don't be getting ahead of me on that. I said, well, hell, I enjoy it. But it hurt my wife's back, you know. And remember when you were growing up, how somebody that you loved a lot would say things out of ignorance that would embarrass you sometimes? My mother would do that. Somebody remember back in high school when you had to diagram sentences? My mother was at a PTA meeting. She asked my teacher, she said, how's Junior doing? That was me. Teacher said, well, he's doing pretty good, but he's having trouble with his dangling participle. True story. My mother says, well, he can't help it. It's been that way since he was 3 years old. What happened was he got it caught in the spokes of his tricycle. Looked awful, went right over the handlebars. He just laid out there and hollered. See, when you're a small child, the adult language doesn't make any sense. My mother would come out on the porch and she'd say, if you fall out of that tree and break your leg, I'm gonna whoop your butt. I'm thinking, what a cruel woman. Gonna beat up on a cripple like that, yeah. So, when you drive along all the highway construction here in Atlanta, every 50 yards they put a sign up that says, road narrows. You know what that means? Sometime in the past, some nut has said to his wife, honey, I believe our car just got wider. Starting tomorrow, you'll be doing this. You know, every time you see a sign, you'll say, know what that means? I like working here. I was just up in up north, out in the Pacific Northwest, and Oregon is like Illinois, California, New York. They have these state lotteries where an average guy, any day if his number comes up, he'd win $20 million. A guy, when I was out there in Portland, he won $20.5 million. They had him on the nightly news, and he said the same thing they all say. Well, yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and keep my job. Don't you feel like stomping the TV? Here's what I'm going to tell them when I win my $20 million. I'm going to tell them, I'm going to say, the following people can kiss my rich, fat ass. Number one, my ex-wife. We got to get out of here. Here's a little tip for you all. Some night when you're sitting home watching television by yourself, you need a laugh, and a commercial comes on. Close your eyes during the commercial so you're not looking at it. And if you're not looking at it, you will listen more carefully, and you'll soon realize that during these commercials, they're telling us things we don't need to know, information we don't need. You know the commercial for Preparation H? I'm not going to make fun of it. It's what they tell us. They say 30 million Americans have hemorrhoids. The first thought that comes to my mind is, wonder who counted. And how would you go about applying for that job? Yeah, I'm here about to add in the paper. It's a career move. This is a product manufactured for a very limited market. If you use Preparation H, you have a problem. Trust me, this is not an impulse purchase. It's not like some guy just strolling down the aisle of the grocery store. He happens to see it on the shelf one day, and he says, my, my, my. I simply must try some of this. No. If he buys it, he knows what to do with it. But yet, on every package of Preparation H you've ever seen in big, bold letters, it says, use only as directed. You know what that means? Sometime in the past, some nut has said to his wife, honey, wonder how this would taste on crackers? Good night. God bless you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah. James Gregory. Well, we want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. We want to thank 96 Rock, of course, for sponsoring us. And we want to thank Pinsky and Gray, the comedy team you saw tonight. Yeah. J. Anthony Brown. Louis Nixon. Jeff Foxworthy. Yeah. Rob Cleveland. Tim Wilson. Myself, my name's Grant Turner. Thank you. Good night.
The owner says he wants to make the people laugh. Don't mess with any other waitress staff. And don't go on stage with no frown on your face, because there's too many people want to take your place. And look alive, we want a tight 25. The heckler's in the back and he's raising hell. Some of the jokes ain't going over too well. You done tried every line on this fool.
shoes and you go